horse, people. Well, shit. I've been asked like a thousand times, do something of Warwick Schiller. Warwick Schiller? Look, I've been hearing this guy's name for a while. I think this is might be one of the... Maybe I watched a video. Maybe I did a video on him before. I don't know. I just don't remember this guy being a big circuit guy to where I see him a lot. I'm not saying he's bad or good. I thought I saw that he is on the board of directors for a horse charity about 2 hours away from me, which I thought was pretty cool. That he's actually, you know, giving back to the horses instead of just taking. But, and maybe it's a different guy. I don't know. So, look, I'm going to say right now, because I know I'll have the little barn witches fly over here on their brooms and do their little flyby comments. You don't even know him! No shit. That's what I just said. So, go fly somewhere else and go fly around your barn and cause drama there. So, in this video, he talks about foals and everything, and I'm going to go through the video. And it's about a 6-minute video, so it'll probably take me 30 minutes or an hour to go through. But, so let's kind of listen to him. I had him on double speed, or time and a half. So I'll put him down to 1 1/4, because he talks kind of slow and I talk kind of fast. Here we go.
G'day, I'm Warwick Schiller, and I want to introduce you to our new foal, Chance. Hey, mister, how you going?
And again, if you want to go watch this video, go watch it. Touching a foal that can't be touched. All right? I'm here to stop and pause and to tell you what I see when I see it, what I'm thinking, what I think the horse is thinking, and what's going on. So the first thing I see when I come in here is all these freaking braids, and I'm just like, Jesus Christ. And I see this tail wrap and this tail braid. So the horse can't shake flies off or shake. It's got to be freaking humanized. So that was kind of a turnoff right off the bat. At the beginning of this, I think it showed him.
G'day, I'm Warwick Schiller, and I want to introduce you to
it was here.
Mother here, Bella. She is a...
So he's talking about riding this horse here. And when I'm watching this, I'm like, really? Are you kidding me? So everybody always told me what a great guy he was and everything. And if you notice, he's got big old spurs in this horse right here, digging in right there. I am anti-metal, anti-spur, anti-bit. So anybody that wears spurs, I'm not a fan of. I don't like it. Doesn't mean he doesn't know what he's doing. Doesn't mean he's a great guy and he saved 14 people in a hurricane and he's a hero. I'm just telling you, if you use metal on a horse, I'm not a fan of it. So just get, don't come here and tell me to go watch somebody and then be offended when I say I don't like him because he wears freaking spurs and he's spurring his horse. And Rick, he's not spurring him. He's giving him direction.
Yeah, okay. So he's by the same sire, and his mother here, Bella, she is a half-sister to Petey's mother. So.
Wow, that was really cool. Wow, look at those spurs. He's a cowboy. Wow. Look at that metal bit, man. He must be really good. Look, I don't like freaking metal on horses. All right, so now I'm going to talk about babies now that I got what I don't like about them. All right, here we go.
G'day, I'm Warwick Schiller, and I want to introduce you to our new foal, Chance. Hey, mister, how you going?
Very cute little foal. He says in this video that he hasn't touched this foal yet, and nobody's touched him. Usually when a foal comes over like this, I'm probably not going to stare at him if I'm trying to touch him. I'm not saying this is bad or good, but you need to be aware. If you stare at a horse and you face him, you're putting additional pressure. If he looked away or turned his body away, he would create a draw. And he kind of goes into this further on in a video. And I don't remember if I watched the whole thing. I kind of just skipped through it really fast. So maybe he goes into it more. But he uses a draw, and that's what I think. You use the horse's curiosity to help what you need. Anytime, see, most people beat the curiosity out of a horse. They beat the playfulness because you have insecure people wearing pink that are insecure and scared of horses. So they get in there and they beat the serious out because they think they have to be tough. And they think they have to show the horse who's boss. And they think they have to have the horse respect his space. What do you think if Mr. Schiller here immediately said, respect my space, don't get close to me, don't let a horse put your nose on you ever, he could bite you. And you hear all this other ignorance that's being taught by all these great experts in the horse world. What do you think that would program into this foal? So He kind of looks at this foal. I don't know if he wants to touch it, if he's just talking. Again, if they haven't touched this foal is, I mean, most foals are pretty easy to touch. They want to play. They're curious. If you can touch the mom, you'll be able to touch the foal. As long as you don't go in there like a freakazoid, loving pink monster trying to freaking baby and hug and, I love you, give me a hug, I want to kiss you, and you go at the face and you're reaching and grabbing, you can pet a foal. Now, he's saying he went to some lady's house where they said this foal is untouchable. Yeah, okay, I've heard that about 1,000 times. This horse, you can't catch it. And I go over there and catch it in freaking like 10 minutes. This horse, you can't touch it, and you're touching it in 10 minutes. You can't touch it because you don't know what the hell you're doing and you're the problem. That's why you can't touch it. But you can't say that if you're trying to make money and make friends. So this guy didn't want to tell this woman that. But if you call me and tell me, I got a foal I can't touch, I'm going to say, it's you, it's not the foal. Look at what you're doing. You're freaking causing it not to be able to touch. Well, Rick, that doesn't help. And you just hurt my feeling. Whatever.
So he's about babies. 5 weeks old now, I think. He's out of Bella here. And he's actually...
Darling little foal, very curious. All foals, all horses stay curious. If it's not beat out of them with, respect my space, respect my bubble, don't you come up on me unless I ask. You're being disrespectful, I'm going to make you run circles. Oh, man, all that great horse training.
Three-quarter brother to the horse I showed at the World Equestrian Games last year. So he's by this Petey's.
All right, we already saw him spurring Petey's crap out.
I have been posting on social media how I haven't actually been touching Chance right here.
Okay, so by walking away from a foal that's curious, what's he doing? He's creating a draw. He's creating a curiosity. He's pulling and drawing the horse in because the horse is curious, and the horse is like, oh, this guy's not trying to touch me. He must not be a threat. Remember, a horse is a prey animal. So they're always trying to figure out whether you're a predator or you're not, whether you're a threat or not a threat. And then once they determine that you're not a threat, then they got to figure out whether you're higher or they're higher. So they're always going to try and push the limits a little bit to figure out if they're higher or you're higher. And with foals, I don't mind if I'm trying to touch them to let them think they're higher. I might let this foal think that he's pushing me. I might move away when he comes up every time. Pretty soon he'll be like, hey, I'm high horse. I can make this guy move. Then if he gets too aggressive or he tries to bite, kick or whatever, or jump on you, then you let it go too far and you need to back him down and make him move away and show him that you're not lower. But, you have to first establish you're not a threat, and being a threat can be trying to hug it. Well, Rick, hugging a horse isn't threatening. Yeah, it is, you big dummy. You're reaching and grabbing and trapping. It is threatening. But, Rick, I love him, and it can be threatening. Well, that's because you're an idiot. You don't listen. Anytime you act like a predator, reach, grab, pull, hold, restrain a horse, block their path, you're being predatory behavior. You're being threatening behavior. Now, with a full-grown horse, you can use those techniques to control, move his feet, and show your dominance and show that he's not higher and control the horse. But with a foal, if you do that too quick, you're going to get them to where they're scared of people and they don't want to be touched.
We've allowed him to come and interact with us. Like, if he wants to come sniff us, that's fine. But actually, none of us have actually laid a hand on Chance. And there's a...
Now, who thinks he could touch his horse right now? He absolutely could touch him. But how he touched him would be what would happen next. If he touched him very slightly and moved away, if he touched him when he turned his back as he was walking away, it would be less threatening than if he touched him when he was facing him. If he didn't reach out and have to grab and touch him, that would be better. Because if he reached out, then he's being predatory. Then he's trying to trap. Then the horse is going to be, why are you trying to grab me? Why are you reaching to me? Horses don't do that. I rub on horses. They rub on me. I go in and they go in. So if you think like a horse, then you're going to be able to understand what the horse is telling you, and you'll be able to adjust because of what he's thinking, meaning, oh, I must have done this wrong. Oh, I must have done something that caused the horse to do that. Therefore, I must change my behavior because I'm causing the horse to do whatever the horse does.
There's a reason I'm doing that. You know, in the past, I've handled these foals quite young and gotten used to a lot of different things, and it works fine if you just want to really just...
Notice how the mom isn't trying to touch the horse. I mean, when a baby's born, a mom licks it, gets a smell on it, bonds with it, spends some time with it. Yeah, I get it. But a horse is curious and they want to go back, but they're going to go where they're safe. They're in their learning phase. They're just hitting the ground and they're like, everything's fearful except my mom so far. So unless my mom tells me it's okay, or unless I want my mom, I don't feel real safe. Then as they grow in confidence and size and they feel the ability to move and they explore and they test things and they bite things and kick things, and then they get more, either they gain more confidence Or it gets beat out of them by people telling them to respect their space. This foal is disrespectful. I need to sack this foal out. I'm going to lock it in a corner and shove plastic bags in his face and show it who's boss and show it doesn't have to be fearful. If you do ignorant shit like that, then you're going to ruin a foal. To me, that's just basic common sense. And for people who supposedly should have two brain cells to rub together that can't figure that out and continue to do the same thing because they see people who are popular or have videos or whatever do the ignorant shit, I just don't get it.
Quiet sort of a horse, but I do think they lose just a little bit of that spark in there. And, you know, it's funny when you start posting things on social media. I've been telling people on social media that I'm not actually, haven't actually touched him yet, and I'm not planning to touch him for a little while. And it's amazing the opinions you get about.
You can bet your ass you get some opinions on any media. If you put yourself out there, you're going to get people hating you and loving you and thinking you're mean and thinking you're nice and thinking you're great and thinking you can't do wrong and whatever. I mean, it's just the gamut's out there.
You know, people's opinions on that. And everybody's entitled to their own opinion. This is where I'm at right now. But I had a, one of the reasons I don't want to touch him, I want to keep that natural curiosity in there. And I've got a.
Now, I'm not so sure that not touching a horse is keeping that natural curiosity. I'm not saying this guy's wrong. Don't be coming here. You don't know. He's smarter than you. He's better than you. He's won more ribbons than you. Whatever. Shut up, idiots. You don't want to hear my opinion. Don't come here and play. I'm just telling you, from a horse perspective, I'm not sure not touching them is somehow. I mean, there's a theory that if horses are left out in a herd to be horses, they know how to be a horse, they learn to be a horse, and they end up being better horses later. But they only end up being better horses later if they have better owners that understand them, that use the proper training techniques, that don't beat their curiosity out of them, that don't spur and use pain bits and whip them and make them run circles and do stupid shit. That no matter what the horse is, I can change it. I can take the best horse, best trained, best horse in the world, and I can make him look like shit, and I can untrain him in probably 2 days, get him fearful. I mean, it's just not that hard to change a horse. People change horses every day. They don't know it, and they blame the horse for changing, when in fact, they're the one changing a horse. When you're around a horse, you're training it, whether you think you are or not. You know, that's why I say everyone's a horse trainer. They may not know it, but they're training the horse. They're training them that you're fearful, that you're insecure, that you don't know what you're doing, that you're giving bad clues, that you're flighty, that you're reachy, that you're grabby, that you like to wear pink. You're training the horse every time you're around it, whether you know it or not.
Short video to show you here. I was in Australia earlier this year, and a friend of mine has a foal there, and she said she can't touch him. And
so a friend of mine has a foal. She thinks she can't touch him. See, he did it a nice way. Say, I would be saying, I got this horse owner that think they know everything about a damn horse, and now they want to tell me that you can't touch a horse. Are you freaking kidding me? I mean, haven't you people learned that anytime someone says you can't do something with a horse, there's somebody out there that will come show you it can be done. It's not that hard. Okay? So for the people that still want to run around and claim to know what they're doing and say, no, not this horse. My horse is special. Because I know what I'm doing, and if I can't touch a horse, then nobody can. That's how ignorant that comment is to me. And now you're going to be going to this woman who owns this horse because somebody's going to know her, and I called her an idiot. And look, people, just listen to the message. Quit trying to just stir up shit because you got nothing in your life but drama, and you want more.
And I'm going to show you this video in a second, and it'll show you how I went about touching this foal for the first time. And she said she's tried to touch him, she can't touch him. And this stuff.
Of course she said you can't touch him. You know why? Because she can't touch him. So she tells everybody, this foal won't let you touch him. And then when this guy touches him, you know what? Wow. Man, you must be really special. You got a gift. You must be a horse. You were born to touch. I mean, I get that a lot from people that don't understand. It's not rocket science, people. It's not that hard. You just need to take the time to learn the horse language. Horses talk with their body, not with their mouth. And that's the hardest thing for people to learn, especially when you're running your mouth, because you think that's the only way that you can show how strong, smart, wonderful, independent, great, knowledgeable you are. And when you're working with horses, they don't care what you say. They don't care how many degrees you got or how many ribbons you got on your wall. They care what you do.
It's all based on something I learned from a horseman named Luke Thomas in Australia a couple of years ago. And Luke's an amazing horseman. And he has a job once a year handling about 150 unweaned thoroughbred foals. And I went out there for about 10, 12 days and went through a set of those with Luke and really learned some really cool stuff. And it really kind of changed the way I think about interacting with foals. So have a look at this video with this. This is me first walking into the
What a cute little baby. You know what? You know what my problem would be? Is once I touch this thing, I couldn't keep my hands off it because he's stinking cute. All right, here we go.
And he was living in with this unhandled foal that the owner says she can't touch.
Okay, so as soon as this went on, you tell me which of these babies, because they both look like babies to me. Well, Rick, one of them little or the other one? Well, no shit, one's a little. But to me, they both look like babies, young ponies, colts, fillies, whatever you want to call them, newborns. I mean, I don't even know if they're a yearling. This guy, you know, it depends on what his mom and dad looks like, but he doesn't even look like he's a yearling yet either. And a yearling is a horse that's a year old. So both these are kind of babies in my book. But when I walked in here and saw him, this horse is facing him and this horse has him at the side of his eye. So I'm guessing as soon as I saw this, I go, this must be the one that can't be touched. You notice how Warwick didn't, and I hope I say his name, Warwick. You notice how he didn't react to this horse's butt. Although he kept his eye on him, in case he came in, he was ready. And I guarantee you, this hand, with all this metal and whips or whatever the hell it is, would have swung on this horse had he backed in and tried to kick him. So this is where a lot of people don't understand what's going on behind the scenes, what's going through somebody that handles horses a lot in the back of their mind, what they're thinking. They're not just going out there going, la, 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 I got my pink hat on, I smell good, I comb my hair, let me go out here and play with my horsey, let me lock the gate, and they're in la, la land. No, no, no. People who understand horses going out here, I don't want to get kicked, this is a new baby, I already know it doesn't want to be touched, I need to be aware, I've got one horse here, I'm in a gate, I'm trapped. Where's my escape path? Where's my flight path? How can I get these horses off me if they come at me? These are the things that you're kind of always, you know, for my cop channel, on Good Luck America, I'm always talking about what cops think and everything. And the big thing as a cop is, and I know I'm going to piss some people off here because it's just a comment, people. And it's not just for cops, it's for anybody. And there's a saying that says, be nice to everybody and be friendly, but always have a plan to kill them. And that's just a way of kind of reminding people that, hey, you better be aware, things happen very quick. If you don't have a plan, if you're not thinking ahead, you're going to be a victim. And when something happens, you're going to go into panic and go, oh my God, I could never see this coming. I had no idea this could happen. And then you end up being a victim. So for people in a career field where bad things happen very quickly, you have to have that mindset that things can go wrong, they will go wrong. You better have a plan to get out of it. And you better prepare in case and what if and but if and but coconuts. Shit, I can't say my saying now. If and butts and coconuts, that's what I was trying to say. You know, it can happen. So you damn well better be ready for everything. So I guarantee you this guy, because he's been around horses for a while, he knows he's not turning his back. He doesn't put his butt to this horse that could be misconstrued as a challenge that he was going to kick him or try to move him. He doesn't turn away, but he doesn't face him and try to reach out and grab him and make him run away. He appears to the horses, I'm no threat. I'm not trying to catch you. I'm just locking the gate. We're all in here together, no problem. All that is happening while this guy's locking the gate, and then people will come here and go, Rick, this was a 6-minute video, and you talked for 30 minutes. I'm tired of it. Shut up, you freaking idiots. There's a lot going on that you don't understand, and I'm trying to pull back the curtain and tell you what good horse people that understand horses are thinking and doing that they don't want to tell you, because if they tell you all this, then suddenly you don't need them. And I'm not saying he's doing this, but anybody in a profession is not going to give away his secrets. Magicians don't tell you how they make shit disappear because you wouldn't go watch them, okay? So, I mean, look, the best magicians out there are politicians because you give them money, they can make his shit disappear, but I digress. So look, this guy is thinking about a lot of things, and it's not by accident that he ended up with a side view with this horse and his peripheral vision. Now, he knows already that this horse is the one he can't touch. And they were by the gate. Now, I know a lot of other people with pink whips and pink bags and pink things that would have came out here and get away from the gate. Get back. Get away. I got to come in here. It's unsafe. I'm not going to come in here. Get away. And they would have done all that to show their strength and power and, you know, empowerment over these horses. And that's the way they would have done it. The way Warwick did it is kind of the way most people that understand horses would do it. Not a big deal. I'm coming to the gate. I got to be ready, but Most horses don't attack for no reason. If they do, I can handle it. So all that is going on in this still version of what's happening. And other people are watching. Rick, I just want to watch the video. I don't want to hear you talk. Then don't hit play, you freaking idiots. All right, here we go. So now he does turn his back. I don't know this. I gave him all this credit for using. And now he turns his back. Is that good or bad? I'm not sure I would have turned a back on a horse that a lady said I couldn't pet. Maybe he evaluated before. To me, this is a little close. I wouldn't have done this. Now, is somebody going to say that you said Warwick doesn't know what he's doing and you're better? That's not what I'm saying. He can do what he wants. Okay? He's successful. He understands horses. He can do what he wants. I'm just telling you, me personally, I like the way he was standing before. And the fact that this gate is designed that you got to turn your back and reach around with both hands, tell me this is a bad gate design. Rick, this lady says she can't touch a horse and now you're cracking on her because she don't know how to install a gate. Well, you know what? Sometimes if the shoe fits, put it on and shut up. Here we go. So he's watching him here. See that? He's keeping his eye on him. Watch him. Watch Warwick give him a little eye. And I don't know if he missed that kick. Who thinks this horse could have kicked him? Hell yeah, he could have kicked him. He's got his back to him. But Rick, the horse wasn't a kicking horse. You just can't touch it. Why would a horse that you can't touch kick? Because a horse that you can't touch is usually flighty. That means they're flighty because they're fearful, because they've been taught to run away. And they've been taught to run away for survival, because that's what horses do when they're scared. And that's what they do. So they're not running away to be mean and because they didn't like your pink dress or whatever the hell else you want to make the excuse they're running away for. They're running away because they don't trust you, because your actions and behavior tell you that you're a threat and you're making them run away. So horses that run away tend to be fearful. I don't turn my back normally on fearful horses, because even though he runs away, he may also feel a little threatened or feel a little confidence because he's in here with this guy and he's got me trapped. So that's just me. I'm not saying, you know, my way is the only way. I'm just telling you why I would do it my way and maybe try and explain why he's doing what he's doing. Okay, first thing he does is he doesn't go after the horse that the lady says can't touch. And that's what most people do that don't understand horses is lady will tell them, nobody can touch his horse. Everyone's tried. You can't touch him either. And a person goes in there and goes, come here, baby. Come here. Sticks their hands out, reach out in front. Come here, baby. I got a cookie for you. And then the horse runs off. And it's like, damn, you're right. You can't touch him. Well, no shit. I'm doing the same stupid shit that you're doing when you can't touch him. The last thing I want to do is what you're doing, because what you're doing don't work. My guess is, and this is just a swinging wild ass guess, call it a swag. My swag is, this woman has never gone in here and not tried to touch this horse. Rick, you don't know, she's really good. She tried everything. And okay, whatever.
So right then, he turned and looked at me like that. And when he does, I'm just going to go away. I really want to have him. Hey, sweetie, I'm going to catch you. I'd really want to have.
Okay, now turning your back now, I'm okay with. Well, Rick, you just said you wouldn't turn your back. I wouldn't turn my back when I'm blocked in a corner and a horse has his back to me and we haven't had any really interaction. Because he walked in here and a horse showed curiosity and they had some interaction and he didn't walk to the horse and the horse doesn't see him as a flight or a fearful thing now. The horse is kind of curious. Now I'm okay with turning my back. But Rick, he could bite you. He could. He can nip. Babies nip sometime and that's okay. If he nipped me, he'd run into an elbow and be like, damn, I shouldn't nip because that makes my face hurt. But, I mean, we're not talking about nipping here. We're talking about touching. And I would turn my back where he does here.
I really want to.
So he keeps the horse here, and he's evaluating this horse pretty quickly. The horse is curious. He's not being aggressive. He's not pinning his. He's not trying to push him. He's not stretching his neck out, showing, you know, I'm trying to snake you and show you that I'm higher. This horse isn't showing any aggressive posture, so now I feel more comfortable. One, I'm not trapped in a corner with my back to you. And two, I've got a little bit more control because I got a second horse I can get between and there's places I can move. So this is why I don't mind when he turns his back here.
Hey, sweet, I'm going to catch you. I'd really want to have him thinking.
Actually, turning your back here kind of makes the horse think, this guy's not ignoring me. He's not trying to teach me. I'm kind of curious now. He's creating a curiosity draw out of this horse. Like, man, this guy comes in here and starts touching another horse. He's ignoring me. Why ain't he paying attention to me? What's up with that? He's a baby. He kind of thinks like a baby, but he still thinks like a horse. If you reach, grab, restrict, or try to... But Rick, I'm not trying to grab him. I just want to pet him. See, you don't get it. And those are excuses I get when I try to explain things. And then other people say, Rick said you should never pet a horse. I never said you should never pet a horse. I'm saying if you're reaching out petting a horse that doesn't want to be petted and doesn't know what petting is and you haven't established a relationship, then the horse is going to think you're reaching is a grab predatory act that's going to create fear and flight response. Gosh, man, it's so hard to explain when people are always looking for a reason to be offended. There's a professional victimhood in the horse world. And if you say anything against anybody, I'm a victim and you're a bully and you can't say that. And I'm empowered and I'm strong and I'm going to go cry in the corner because you were mean to me and I'm so strong. Whatever.
What I don't want to do is have him going away from me. So I don't want to try to touch him or anything like that that would cause him to...
Now, a lot of people I know, when a horse touches you and you don't want them to touch them, they elbow you, they kick you, they put you away. I do not push horses away from me unless they do something that threatens me, like nip, pull my shirt, bite my shirt, nibble. If they start nuzzling, I go, you know what? A bite might be coming next, because a lot of horses will nibble and then they tend to use their teeth to scratch and bite. And I don't want a horse putting his teeth on me. That's a deal breaker, no go. You kick, you rear at me, or you bite me. Those are deal breakers. I go spastic. I turn into a mean, brutal, mean guy, and I'm going to put the fear of life in you, and you're going to run and be like, holy shit, I don't want this to happen again. And hopefully you connect the two with my timing that, you know what, I don't ever want to put my teeth, kick, or rear at this guy because he just kind of freaks out. So those are my deal breakers. Some people will say, well, that's too aggressive. If you taught a horse right, you would never need... Whatever, people. Train your horse the way you want. If you're here... Hopefully you're here because you want to learn and you want to experience a little bit deeper than respect my space and show the horse who's boss. Because that's the easy, normal shit that people tell you because they don't know any better.
Did you leave? Right here, he's sniffing me. What I wouldn't do is turn around and try to touch him. I'm going to go over here. I kind of want him keeping.
Okay, so he created a draw. The little horse is running around. He's getting excited. Of course, Warwick is keeping his eye. This horse is not the threat. This horse, he was able to get a halter on, he control him. Actually, this horse can be, and I've used other horses before against other horses that were coming in being aggressive. If I got another horse, I can put that horse between me and that horse, and another horse can stop another horse who's trying to bite. And if the horse isn't being aggressive to the horse, he's being aggressive at me, I can use that horse and maneuver that horse as kind of like a shield. Now, I don't want to put my horse in harm's way if a horse is kicking and put my horse out there to get kicked and get a broken leg or broken rib. I wouldn't do that. I'd let my horse go and then I'd defend myself. But in some situations, you can use a horse as a barrier. In this situation, this horse is a great little barrier for this guy if he's trying to keep him away. I'm not sure I would try to ignore him as much as he is, but I get what he's doing. I'm going to create curiosity and a draw. I'm going to do the exact opposite of everybody that came in here and tried to touch his horse. And the horse has told them, no, if you try to touch me, I can run and I can get away. And now they believe, this horse won't let anybody touch him. He's scared. He won't let him. It's not me. It's the horse. It's not the horse, you big dummy. It's you. So, oh, shit, I'm almost at 30 minutes. All right, well, I'm halfway through the video. 3 minutes. Rick, you talk to us. Shut up. Don't come back for part 2. All right, we'll end that there. I'll go to part 2.
I kind of want to keep him wanting more.